Welcome to the What's the Dammage podcast with your host, Leo Van Dammage.
And we're live. Hi. Yeah, you good?
Yeah, I'm good. Hi.
Okay. Hi, guys. This is Leo Van Dammage. Sorry, I don't edit the beginnings of these things, so I'm just going to go out and say what I need to say. But so this is What's the Dammage podcast. I'm Leo Van Dammage, and I am sitting here today with Claire Winter from Claire Winter Animations. How are you getting on, Claire?
I'm good, thank you.
Yeah, how good. Are you? Good. Thanks for having me. I know it was obviously a bit of a convoluted way of setting this up, but we got it done. It figured out in the end, and it's all good. I'm finally sitting down. Claire, tell the people, what do you do?
So everybody, I'm an animator, and that's quite a broad genre.
It is, yeah.
So I suppose my specific animation technique would mainly be 2D animation, and I like to be experimental with that as well, and lots of different textures and techniques, just anything that expresses the story.
2D animation's quite even that's a broad term, because like Simpsons, I'm using this as an example for people that may not be as well versed, just like me. I'm not well versed in animation, so like, let's say for example, give an example of like famous 2D. So we're talking Simpsons, Family Guy.
Yeah, okay. Well, I would say I'm more kind of like the snowman, like,
right, okay, that's cool.
Yeah,
yeah, no, okay,
kind of sketchy, like more kind of free style. With the Simpsons, I think they usually kind of stay on character quite a lot. On character, I'm doing inverted commas, is when you kind of make your characters look the same for every frame, whereas mine is more kind of loose, and their face may change a little bit, so what, you know, they come back to being who you...
It's more raw, yeah. Basically. Yeah, yeah, no, that's cool. I like that sort of stuff. And how long have you been doing that then?
So I discovered that I wanted to do animation at the end of university. I was studying graphic design, and so that was like 2008.
Do you know how many people I've met that went to fucking university and haven't, were like, oh, I studied this, but now I do something that's mildly related but almost completely not related.
There's a lot of people, like, you just don't find out what you want to do until later on.
I think that's one of the shittest things about the current education system, is that they expect you to make a decision so early about what the fuck it is you want to do with your life. And you're like me, I don't even know what I want to do with my life, and I'm 28. Yeah. So I'm like, do I want to do this? Maybe not. But yeah, okay, so you were at university, and then at the end you were like, I'm going to do some animation, this is what I love.
Yeah, I was, I just didn't know what I wanted to do, and then I was like, wait a minute, I want to make these pictures move. What the hell, I'm just going to go and make a flick book. I was always making flick books anyway, but then just thought I want to make a narrative because I like stories as well. And the best way I found to express that was drawing, because I was good at it. So I just did it, drew some funny characters, made some films, and entered some competitions. And I ended up, after working in retail, I'm going, what the hell am I doing? Applying for a place at the NFTS.
What's NFTS?
The NFTS is basically like the best film school in the world at the moment.
Oh, that's a bold claim, Claire.
Well, it says it there. You go on the website.
Does it say on their website?
Well, yeah, I think it does.
I'm going to put on the website of my podcast, if you just got to the SoundCloud page, people, I'm going to put on their best podcast in the world.
You can do that.
Can I? I don't know if that's a bold... I don't know if I'm breaking some sort of claim. Someone could sue me and say, actually, it's not...
Who would sue you? Who would come out of the woodwork and...
People come out of the woodwork to sue everybody, Claire. Like, people, you've ever heard that, I don't know if it's an umbrella. I think it's a true story. The guy broke to somebody's house, and then in the process of breaking in, he broke his leg, and he sued the family and won.
Did you just hear that from Liar Liar?
No, that's a real thing. No, I'm so sure I've heard it.
I swear it's in that film.
It might be in that too, but they may have taken that from a real story.
I think it probably was.
It probably was.
That's something that happens in America though, right?
Yeah, I don't think it happens. It's like, I think the most we get are those people like injury lawyers for you, like, oh, I tripped over in work accidentally on purpose, and yeah, now I want $4,000. Yeah. Give me all of the monies, all of them. Wow. Okay, that bit, so the best, so I'm not going to use inverted commas because you are very talented, so we're going to say it was the best because you came out well. It was, yeah. Okay, so the best film school in the world.
Yeah, uh-huh. I applied for that with a film, didn't get in, made another film next year.
What do you mean, like what kind of film?
An animated film.
Yeah, but I mean like, I don't know why, in my head, when you say animated film, yeah. I think stop motion animation in my head. Right. I don't know why I have that in my head, but I do.
Kind of, this one was kind of, well, I made a set, it was a model, and but I had 2D characters in that set.
Okay, so yeah, like a diorama kind of thing.
Kind of,
yeah.
It was like kind of abstract.
Right.
And I can see why I didn't get in, because it obviously, it was funny, it was more like a sketch. I like comedy, by the way. But so I needed to build more of my narrative, because this going to this film school, their course was all about story and narrative and how you can really tell the character's journey. So I really worked on that for a year, got in, was like over the moon because it's really what I wanted. So I finally knew what I wanted to do.
Where was this school based?
It's in Beaconsfield.
Oh, that's like that's like an hour away.
Yeah, it's okay. Kind of out there. It's like in the middle, it's just such a unique environment. It's in the middle of tiny little town, countryside town.
It's actually, I'm going to drop some knowledge on you here. It's actually a Tudor town.
Okay.
It was, because I did a field trip there when I was a child. And and you know what the most traumatic thing about that entire process was? They made me walk half a mile. I was 8. And they were like, yeah, we're going to walk half a mile from the new town to the Tudor town. And but that's how I know that. But yeah, go ahead. I'm filled with useless information. I'm going to learn, and you're going to learn today. We're both going to learn from each other.
I didn't know it was a Tudor town. Thank you for letting me know. Even though I went there for like 2 years.
Yeah.
I should have known that.
No, it's cool. You were too busy making art.
Oh, God, yeah.
Yeah, that's it.
Very, very busy. So basically, it was a bunch of international, crazy, eccentric, passionate film students. And then there were the local Beaconsfield people who put up with us, and that was great. It was a very nice mixture of people.
Oh, by the way, we have a door open, and so flight, you may hear a buzzing of a flight. It's all good, we love nature in my show, so I really don't mind. It doesn't bother me, but I'm just saying, if people are going, what the fuck is that buzzing?
Sorry, it's a massive fly.
It just flown in through the window, but it's all good, we're good. But
it's
go ahead.
It kind of reminded me of a project that I actually am in the middle of writing.
Okay.
And developing.
That's a shameless plug there, Claire.
It was quite neat though. It was quite like,
go on, tell me about it.
Well,
because I specifically didn't want to hear about this before we started the podcast.
No.
Because I wanted you to tell me as a fresh thing. So,
well, this is something, my own work, which is not commissioned by anyone. This is something that I've dreamt up and want to express, and I'm trying to find funding for, which is kind of impossible.
Yeah, it's difficult out there. Yeah. How much do you need?
$10,000 would be good.
$10,000. Mm. If I had $10,000, I'd give it to you. If I had $10,000 to spare, I'd give it to you.
I really don't believe you, but
no, I would. If I was like,
seen the thing yet?
Doesn't matter. I trust you. If I had $10,000, I'd be like, if I had $10,000 to give, I'd give it to you. Fuck them kids in Africa. I'd give it to you.
It's quite strong, but
yeah, no, but that's my opinion, not yours. Don't worry about it. So what's, do you mind if, am I allowed to know what it's about?
Yes, of
course. Go ahead.
Well, here's the test. This is putting me on the spot with the pitch now. So, I'm just going to lay it out.
Yeah. We're in a boardroom.
Yeah. We are in a boardroom, literally.
We are.
In this film.
Oh, right. Okay, I see.
It starts off in a boardroom.
Right, go for it.
So it's even more intense. So Jenny, well, it actually doesn't start in a boardroom.
It's okay. This isn't a hardcore test.
Okay.
This is a place for you to talk about whatever you want to talk about. Safe place. Pretend I'm Fraser Crane.
Okay. Oh, Fraser.
I'm listening.
Let me talk to you.
Yeah.
So Jenny, she's a sweet little girl. She sits in her garden. She saves flies from her paddling pool. And she watches them disappear into the blue. Like, you know, she just wants to help and save things. Cut to, I don't know, 30 years later, Jenny's like an advertising executive. She's just finished pitching to a boardroom full of clients this horrific fly killing spray advert, and it went down really well because she nailed it. She's good at her job, she's good at what she does, she's a destroyer now. And you know, she sits down, the praise is washing over her, goes over to her business partner, and she hears some screaming noise. She's like, oh, must be some Soho crazy people outside, I'm just gonna chill out and in the confidence that I'm awesome. She hears it again. She kind of looks to the jug in the middle of the boardroom table, and there's this huge fly just kind of doing this crazy backstroke, screaming and shouting and going, help me, for the love of God, help me. It's drowning, and it's pointing at her. It can tell she's noticed. It latches on and it goes, you're gonna save me. And she's like, this is not happening, not a great place to be crazy right now. I'm in the middle of my landing this massive deal, my career's on the line. The fly's like, no, you gotta stop what you're doing right now, you're saving me, like, come on, just save me, woman. And this goes on, and it gets awkward. She tries to kill it, that doesn't work. The fly says something profound, which I'm gonna have to say in the script, I haven't actually got there yet. Makes her change her mind and makes her realize that it's her kind of her inner voice going, you've kind of drastically gone off track here, I'm here to remind you, you're not really a murderer, you're a saver, and everything you've done up to now has kind of been out of bad choices. So she has this huge U-turn in her life right there and has to save the fly in front of all the clients. She gives it mouth to mouth. It gets gross, everyone notices, it's disgusting. And then she's like, what do we do next? The fly's alive, it's like, it's making some dirty noises. And it goes, oh, bye, like, you're on your own, like, I just want you to save me. Just shoots off the table, giving her fingers up, like, two fingers up. Explodes on the ceiling light in a massive spray of gooey innards and singed hair. And all over the client's faces are dripping with goo.
How big is this fucking fly?
It gets big at the end.
Right, okay.
She's looking destroyed. She's like, I just had a life-changing experience. What was this? Clients start clapping, go, oh my God, well done, Jen. Great visual effects. I can't believe you got, I can't believe you made this happen. And she's like, no, it was real. Like, what are you doing? And then she kind of lets the praise wash over her. She goes back to who she was before. And that's the end. She doesn't learn.
I want to see that. Do you know what that reminds me of? You got a big fucking fly next to me.
It's coming.
He heard the story. He's like, hey, I want to be in this. Do you guys need a model? You want
to
draw me?
I do. To animate this damn thing.
That sounds good. Do you know what you have? Are you talking? Are you doing some actual talking on the actual script or for the animation? Or is it all silent animation?
No, I'm too shy. Basically, for acting and stuff.
Too like shy?
Yeah.
You have a fantastic voice.
Oh, thank you.
Like, when you talk, do you know what ASMR is?
No.
Okay, ASMR, I don't know what the acronym stands for, but it's basically a really weird thing that exists where people, they make noises with touching objects, or they talk in a really soft voice like you just did, and it soothes people. It's a scientific thing. It happens, it exists, it calms. Wow, that was weird. Yeah, almost like that, and it calms people down and gets them really relaxed. And you have that voice. Amazing. And whilst you were talking, I was like, oh, I'm so relaxed right now. That's why I sat forward, because I was like, this is really interesting. Because I also didn't hold the mic because I didn't want my heavy breathing to come up, because I thought I was going to fall asleep, but not because I was bored, but because you it was really relaxing. But yeah, I want to see that. I want to see how that translates to animation.
I should have explained something. It's live action and animation.
I was probably gonna assume that it would have to be something like that. So otherwise, it's gonna be super difficult to do on paper. Yeah.
So the only animated character is the fly. And everything else is live action, so I'm gonna have to kind of direct actors. I have done that before, but not extensively. And I'd love
how long to... is it in total, do you think?
It should be about 10-15 minutes.
Right, okay.
Maybe even just 10, because if I get the story like really sweet, like nailed down, I could do it in 10, I reckon.
Have you spoken to, because I know a few filmmakers,
yeah.
Satra and Larry.
Oh, yeah.
I know a few filmmakers, yeah. And I'm sure that those people would love to do a project with you to help you do it.
I would love to crew up as soon as possible.
Yeah.
Well, at least get people attached and interested.
Why does it need to be 10 grand?
Well, the animation.
Because I don't know. I don't know what animation costs or why it does, so I have no idea.
Okay, actually, I will start actually by saying I want to pay everyone because I respect everyone who works with
me. For sure, yeah.
And I want to pay them what they're worth.
Yeah,
this is what the money's going to go to.
There is also a thing out there, especially you being a freelance animator, mm-hmm. I'm sure you hear this bullshit a lot,
mm-hmm.
where people are like, oh yeah, so if you basically you work for free and then you can add to your portfolio, yeah. And you're like, no, how about you go eat a bowl of dicks, my friend? Okay.
a whole bowl
maybe as much two. As maybe yeah. two yeah because people just they underestimate your worth.
They
just say, oh, I'm just gonna do you, you'll do this for free because mm. you need it, you need me because more than I need you,
yeah.
And in fact I think you'll find it's the other way around.
I think
you need to respect people for the work that they put in. So I'm grateful for your time today. I'm not paying you, but I'm grateful for your time today. So I have no money.
This will benefit both of us, I think.
Yeah, but I also have no money. But but on the side note of that, I think I know a lot of people, like models or artists, mm. stuff like that, not animators, but more like VFX people,
mm.
who get offered loads of work, but for free.
Yeah.
Does that happen a lot in your industry?
It does so much. It's ridiculous, really. The low paid, well, actually, I'm kind of a hypocrite at the moment. The film I'm working on, we're kind of...
Can you tell me the... is it a big film, low film, small film?
It's
big?
An independently funded, okay. Animated short. So there's not so much money in it, but it's a really good project. And the reason why I was on board with it from the beginning is because the script was so good. The director Marissa, who wrote the script and is directing it, she's just so lovely to work with. We're like BFFs now.
Do you think she would mind if I plugged her?
No, not at all. Not, I actually
that sounded really horrible, by the way. That sentence. Do you mind if I plugged you? Excuse me.
She's a married woman.
Yeah. You know? Do you think she would mind?
I don't think she'd mind at all. I think she'd actually like that.
Okay, yeah. Cool. Most girls like when I plug. No,
yeah.
That's horrible. I'm not going to go that route. My girlfriend's listening. And my eyes are widening. I was like, what jokes are you making? Shut up, Leo. Shut up before you get in trouble. Before she breaks up with you. Cool. I'll totally link that at the bottom. Do you know what the name of her film or company?
Yeah, the name of the film is Puddle. The company is Stormhouse Pictures.
Okay. Is it her company?
Yes, she's a co-owner. I don't know how, co-director, whatever.
Co-CEO.
Yeah, yeah. Something like that.
Boss lady. We call her boss. Lady. Big boss.
Yeah. She's not that big. She's quite small.
Yeah, but the aura of respect is big. The fact that you can own and run your own company,
mm.
in any format, whether it be big or small, it takes a lot of dedication, and I respect that. So mm. the big boss lady, Marissa
Russell Hammer. Yeah,
well, it's in her last name, Hammer. She's yeah. gonna break motherfuckers. That's it.
That's right.
Yeah,
well, her husband is the other co-owner of the company,
and
he's the Hammer.
He's Mr.
She's
Hammer.
The Russell.
Yeah,
so they were married last year, 2 years ago. Yeah,
I'm not gonna lie, I know they're probably, if they do listen to this, and if they're both listening to this, I'm gonna say this. How old is she?
She's only 27.
Okay, so yeah, she's like my age, right? Yeah. I have to make this joke, okay? So I'm so sure that her husband, his last name being Hammer, I'm sure, I guarantee that he made a hammer and a nail joke at some point. He was like, you're about to get nailed. I'm going to hammer it.
No, you don't think so?
Obviously,
yeah, he probably did.
I absolutely, 100%, I can guarantee putting them on blast right now and saying that that happened.
Knowing them as well, yeah.
Oh, okay.
They have a sense of humor.
For sure. Sure it happened. And and so, yeah. But Stormhouse Pictures. Yeah. Okay, guys. So make sure you check that out. I'm going to put the link in the description.
Excellent.
For Stormhouse Pictures. And the film is called Puddle. With any idea when it's due to be released?
Oh, my God. Hopefully sometime next year.
Okay.
We're working on it now.
We'll touch base after this anyway. Yes. I'm sure we'll keep in contact, and you will just let me know when it's out, and yes, I'll whack it on the page.
Thanks.
And put the trailer out there, and obviously I'll credit you and Stormhouse.
Excellent.
And we'll get it out. Yeah, fantastic. So how long have you been working on that project for?
Almost a year already.
Okay, right. So it's a big thing.
It's a big thing. It's bigger than we anticipated. We thought it would take 3 months, and it's going to take probably 1.5 to 2 years.
Wow. Talk about underestimating the bite, huh?
That's right. Every project is different, and we severely underestimated this one. We've learned. I mean, the learning curve was massive, and we've still got a lot more to learn, I think. As I was saying before, we've got kind of like a team of animation assistants,
okay,
who aren't being paid, but they kind of volunteer because they're university students or college students and they want to get some experience. I know it sounds like...
No. You know, it's understandable. Exactly. Sometimes you have to, if you want to be paid, you have to kind of cut your teeth in the industry. Mm. That also does make sense.
There's a cut-off point though.
I was just about to say that. There is a cut-off point, and that goes for anything. I had a friend of mine, Susie, she's an artist.
Yeah.
She started her own business and she didn't know what to charge people.
Mm.
And she said to me, when we were talking about this, probably about the same thing in the way for you, and your way of thinking, which I respect, is you have to charge what you think you're worth. How much do you think your time is worth? And I'm like, that's, as an animator, you would think your time is worth for a day's work is X. Okay, so I'm not getting paid any more than X. And see, people say, oh, well, I'll pay you in this. No, you'll pay me in cold hard cash because other things aren't going to pay my rent. So that's how this works.
That's how the world works.
Exactly, yeah. Anyway. So I get that. There is a cut off point though. So I think it all comes whenever you think you're ready and you value your own time.
Yeah.
a lot more but
believe me, I wish I could pay these students, I mean even just a token payment, but it's just not within the budget that we have.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I understand, but they're credited and it's good for them as uni students as well, so.
And they're so awesome, and like I'm just making friends basically. It's great.
Well, that's brilliant. I mean, it's a good way, it's good for them to know an experienced animator such as yourself, and it's good for you to be grounded, I guess, and be like, oh, that's where I came from. I don't know what you as a person would get out of it, but if I was working with somebody who didn't really know a lot, but is starting to get into what I do, for example, anything, like if I was an artist, I would take solace in the fact that I get to spread that knowledge and teach people new shit.
I love it.
Yeah?
I really do love it. Like teaching people, and it teaches me, just their perspective, their
especially angle. Patience, right?
Patience, yeah, for the love of God. Yes, yeah, patience. I do have a lot of patience, I think.
You seem like a pretty well-rounded, chilled out person.
I'm chilled.
Do you mind if I ask, do you have a partner?
I do.
Yeah?
He's very lovely and very talented.
Okay.
And I would like to talk about him a bit as well.
You would?
Yeah.
Perfect, go for it, that's fine. No, the reason I asked is obviously it takes a lot of patience in relationships too.
Yeah.
So I would assume that you have a lot of patience.
That's true.
He's a man, I must say, all very as talented and as smart and as good looking as we are. I'm speaking about you, Louise. That's my girlfriend. As good looking as I am, I understand that I can be a lot of work, and all men can be a lot of work in their own little way. So it takes a very patient woman to deal with somebody like me. You are telling me you have a lot of patience. So I'm sure. What's your boyfriend's name?
Leander. Yes.
Okay.
He sometimes goes by Leo, which is interesting.
Which is funny.
Yeah, all the Leos, woo!
Do you want to laugh right now? Do you
want to read that?
Okay. my full first name, Leandro.
What?
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, how weird is that?
Really lovely.
Where's your boyfriend from? Where's what Leander? Where's Leo from? Leander, we're calling him Leander. Where's
let
he
me,
from?
Let me get this right. Hampshire.
Via.
Via Fleet.
Oh, so he's not foreign, or his family background isn't foreign, because Leander's a foreign name.
Yeah, it's, well, it's a Greek, I think, by a Greek mythological name, about a dude who swam across some water and drowned, trying to, like, see his love, called Hero.
Are you Hero?
Hopefully not, because I don't want to be such a douche that I'd make him do that.
Yeah, you'd get on a boat, right? You'd be like, fuck this, and jump it on a boat. What does Leander do?
He is a filmmaker and he's a musician as well.
All right. Is he in a band?
He is.
Why is he not here right now? He should be sitting with us. He should be sitting with us.
You should interview him as well.
Yeah, do it. Like, I'll totally have. What, is he in a big band or small band? Or
his band, well, basically, I love his music.
Okay. I'm not is it like yodeling? Is it yodeling, Claire?
It's not yodeling.
Oh, okay.
I wish it was now, because that'd be funny.
That would be fucking amazing. Seeing him in the Lederhosen, yodeling.
He would so suit the Lederhosen.
Really? Well, yeah. I have to see this.
He looks very European.
Right. Blonde, blue eyes, very Aryan.
Yes, very Aryan.
Oh, nice. Yeah. Nice. The master race. We love
it. Yes, we love the master race.
Cool, perfect. And so he's in a band and he's a filmmaker.
Yes.
Anything I've seen? Or is it small stuff?
No, but his film that he's working on at the moment is called Ouija Sex.
Ouija, as in O-U-G, Ouija.
Yes.
As in Ouija board.
Yes, Ouija board.
And sex.
And sex.
As in penetration, make babies.
Yes, you can imagine the hilarity that ensues. And also,
I would have thought it's kind of like Twister, like sex Twister.
Kind of. Yeah, kind of is. No one's actually described it like that. But it'd be very interesting for you to kind of talk to him about that.
For sure. How old is he?
He's going to be 30 on the 14th.
So, okay, so we're me and him around the same age.
Yeah.
So dick and fart jokes aloft. Where is he local?
He lives in near Crystal Palace.
Fuck. Penn. So no.
No. You could drive there. I mean, it's like...
No, he can come here. It's fine. We can do it here. We'll do it here. We're at your parents' house, actually, right now.
Yeah, we are. It's good of them.
It's much nicer than my place. But
is it? Okay.
It's a house for all intents and purposes. Okay, so... and he is a filmmaker. What is he work for his own company or is he independent?
He's looking for work at the moment.
Right, okay.
He's a writer predominantly.
Okay.
But I'd say that he's like an all-rounder. He's like just... the concept of things, which he's very good at coming up with.
Do you know when he's next free?
No, but...
Leander, hit me up. Yeah, you know where my page is. My emails and shit is going to be on the link of this. You hit me up and we're going to fucking set up a podcast, dude. Okay. Right, we'll do it via Claire, but it'll be me and you. We're going to do this shit. What are we? 27 minutes into the podcast. Tell him when to listen into it. You'll find it. And me and him will sit down. We'll hook this up.
I'm
we'll
make it.
He
to
can email me on Facebook or whatever he wants to do. As long as you like, share, and subscribe, motherfucker, then yeah, no worries.
Okay, nice calling card.
Yeah, that's it. Well, no, yeah. Well, you plug yourself. I'm gonna plug mine. Okay. No, for sure. Yeah, I'm totally down for that. Cool. We'll get him down and we'll sit down and we'll talk about what he's working on at the moment. So you were saying, yeah. So his current project is
it's called Ouija Sex.
Ouija Sex.
It's in almost finished edit now. Almost finished grade. So you're going to see it out there probably at some point in the festivals, hopefully.
Yeah.
Do you ever go to film festivals?
Claire, I love movies and I'm in a podcast with Sasha. I do another podcast called Friends Talk Film.
Okay.
It's a video podcast. This is just a sound. It's a video podcast. So me, him and I sit down and we basically talk shit about films. Mm. I wish I had the time to go to festivals.
Yeah.
Film festivals, I really did. I wish I had the time. But hopefully, anybody who's listening, if you guys feel like inviting me, Claire, and Leander, we will happily come to your film festival and critique your movie for free, of course. we'll provide our own transport, right?
Yeah.
Drop in my car, we'll drive down.
If you want to take a trip to Bristol, like on the 21st.
Is that where his film's being shown?
No, this is where one of my films is being shown. It's in competition at Encounters Film Festival.
How far away is Bristol from here?
Bristol is about 2.5-3 hours.
It's not bad. It's not bad. I think I might just be getting back from a wedding in Spain. Is that on this month, right?
Yes, this month, September.
All right, yeah. I leave for a wedding next week, so there won't be no. So I'm doing all these episodes now, so I can release them before I go. But yeah, I'm in a wedding next week from the 14th to the 20th. Ooh. So I might just miss it. Ooh. I might just miss it. But
it's screening again at another film festival.
Where?
Where is it? Is it Earl's Court? I think it's Earl's Court.
Film. That's even better. I'll go to that one because that one's just down the road. I can drive to that one. I'm down for that.
This film's called After I Saw You, and it's a collaboration between the director who found a poem online, a poet, should I say.
Yeah.
Who lives in California, and her poem kind of touched the director, Yolanda. Like
the cockles deeply. Of her heart.
It did, yeah. Mm. Like deep within the cockles. And she said, I have to make a film about this. So she just was like putting an advert out there online. I think she'd actually found me. She just said, are you interested in making a film with me? Because I've seen your work. I think you'd be good for this. And for kind of like, we just did this with no money. We just made a film together because we were interested in the poem.
All the way from California.
Yeah.
So you guys worked together, collaborated online, basically.
Yeah.
It's amazing, the fucking internet, right?
It's amazing.
The shit that we can do.
And you know something even more amazing? This artist, Leah Perlman, who was the poet, and she wrote the poem.
Yeah.
Turns out after the film was made, we put it online, it kind of went viral, and my cousin watched it. And was like, oh, this film's amazing. Yeah, I really love it. And at the end, he was like, Claire Winter, animator. He's like, what? I know Leah Perlman. She's my friend. And we hadn't had this connection. Like, I didn't know my cousin knew the poet until this point. And
it's amazing how small the world is. Yeah.
It's just weird the way he knew her. And we just didn't know.
And so... Have you and this Leah Perlman, have you guys had conversations? Have you spoken?
We haven't. We've never spoken.
That's fucking insane. Why is that not happening?
I don't know. I just don't know. I hope that we will very, very soon.
Because you put an image to her poem.
Mm.
And you put that out to the world.
We've just emailed.
And you haven't. Yeah, you need to have a conversation.
We need to Skype, I think.
Yeah, Skype, man. She opens up a bottle of Merlot, you open a bottle of Merlot, put the Skype camera on and you go for it.
Well, definitely if we win something at Encounters, which is...
is that what it's called? The Film Festival?
Encounters Film Festival. Okay. It's an Academy recognised festival. So being up for award there means if you... Well, automatically you can enter like the BAFTAs or the Oscars. So it's like quite a big deal. And I really didn't think this film would get that far and people just love it so much.
How long is it?
It's about 2-3 minutes long. God,
you need to send me the link to this.
I will send you the link.
Is it on the YouTubings?
Yes, the YouTubings.
Yeah, okay. Get it to me and I'll get it out there. Like I said, I my podcast isn't big, but I like to speak to people who have a voice.
Good.
And you have a voice, whether it be using metaphorically pen to paper, pencil to paper, or like me, big mouthed, Big Leo's Big Mouth, which is also the name for this podcast at one point, but it wasn't. It's What's the Dammage instead.
I can't wait for you and Leo to get together.
Leo's. What's he like?
He's very talkative.
Yeah, fantastic. Does he swear and like? Does he like movies?
I suppose so.
He's a filmmaker, but he might not like the same movies that
he has a lot of opinions on movies.
Amazing. I'm down for that. Yeah. I'm actually genuinely excited. Leander, get on this shit.
Excellent.
Will he listen to this?
Yeah, of course.
I like how you're like, he fucking better.
I know, like...
He fucking better. He fucking should. I'm his girlfriend. I'm on the fucking podcast. He will listen to me. Because he doesn't fucking listen to me every other day.
Uh-oh, there's slight truth in that. No, not really.
No, of course not. Yeah. So if you're listening, man, for sure hit me up. All the deets are in all my contact details and stuff. Hit me up. We will definitely talk. If not, I think Claire will just give you my number.
Yeah, I will.
Just fucking text me. It's all good. Okay, so we digressed a little bit because we were talking. Because whilst I'm happy to talk about the projects you're on, I want to talk about you.
Oh, Oh.
Yeah, I want to talk about you. So you were in Beaconsfield.
Yes.
You were training at this school.
I was, yeah.
You did 2 years. What happened after? So you did university, graphic design in university.
Yeah.
And then you were like, I'm going to do 2 more fucking years in this school.
Yeah,
are you just a glutton for punishment? Like, in the, I mean, obviously I understand wanting to follow your dreams, but that's fucking difficult.
I know. Well, I had a break kind of for 2 years working in jobs I didn't want to do while I was thinking, what do I want to do? And making films while I was doing it. And I was like, of course, I want to make films. So I want to be a professional at doing that. So I need to go to a good film school. The film school didn't feel like education. It felt like traditional, you know, in the sense, traditional education. Oh, no, thanks. It felt like just like this really tight group of amazing, challenging, creative people that just wanted to play, and people that just knew, like, that you wanted to express yourself and helped you do that. It's just so much growth in that place, and I loved every minute of it, even though it was the hardest thing I've ever done.
So, have you ever heard the phrase, something my old man used to say to me, if you're the smartest person in the room, you're in the wrong room?
This is something I think,
which what you've just described to me sounds exactly like you're in the right room.
I believe that too, and I believe Leander, like, totally believes that ethos as well. So yeah, I was definitely, I had a huge way to come. I kind of got in by the skin of my teeth and wasn't quite ready, but I learned so much from my peers and I had so much respect for them, and I ended up making a film just about like not dying, and yeah, the rest is history really. I'm an animator now.
Yeah,
this is what I do. I'm a
director. Why did you, is it always like freelance, or can you, or are there avenues for people to go and work for a company, or, you know, whatever?
Definitely, like, it depends on what you want to do. If you're more of like a concept, a storyteller, director like me, you probably will have to try and fight it out for yourself. Because
is it a hard slug out there?
Yeah, I think it is.
Like, is there a lot of competition and stuff like that?
Yeah, there's a lot of competition. Like, anyone can make a beautiful picture. I think lots of people are very talented at drawing and, mm-hmm. and design, but when it comes to storytelling, there's an extra step there, and that's what kind of makes you stand apart as a filmmaker in animation. Like, you can make a beautifully animated sequence, but it sometimes it could mean nothing, which doesn't really interest me. What interests me is the story. So I think it's harder for people like me to get into like the industry through traditional routes.
Okay.
If I'm like more of a storyteller. But if I want to work on other people's things or do adverts, then that becomes easier. I worked with a TV company called El Arabi TV for like a week because my friends worked there, and he also a graduate of an FTS. And yeah, I was making good money, and I was doing kind of like story sequences for them that weren't really that narrative. It was kind of like intro sequences to their show. And I was like, I'm not really sure if I like doing this. I prefer to do something more story based.
Yeah.
So that's kind of the reason why I'm kind of out here now doing this in my parents' house, like sitting in my pants mostly, and other things like a dressing gown.
That almost turned R-rated there, Claire. Jesus Christ.
Yeah, I know.
Children might fucking listen to this podcast. Okay. I say fuck when I say that. No, children ain't listening. If you're listening to this and you're under the age of 18, don't tell your parents. Go ahead and listen, just not to your parents. Otherwise, you shouldn't be listening to this. That's my official stance.
Sorry if I painted that picture.
You're a good looking chick. It's good, man. I'm sure some people don't know what you look like. Google her. I'm sure you'll find it. You're a good looking chick. I'm sure guys would totally. That actually brings me on to something we were going to talk about a little while ago. Do you remember? So,
yeah.
A little anecdotal thing about. Excuse me. Sorry, clearing my throat there. So basically, when I asked you to come do this podcast, you weren't too sure, even though my Facebook basically says I'm practically married. You weren't too sure whether or not this was like whether or not I was like fucking using this as a ploy, like Barney Stinson from How I Met Your Mother.
I wasn't
call it the animator, the podcaster that's in the playbook.
I didn't think that, but it's something that our friend said that misinterpreted it as that, I think.
Our
mutual friend who we will not mention. Which led me on to think about, yeah, maybe sometimes women get kind of propositioned in this way. They think it's a ploy for something else. I didn't think that about this, but now I'm starting to think, God damn it. No, I'm not.
Oh shit, I'm in so much trouble.
Yeah, so much. No, I'm joking.
No, so basically, like you were saying to me, obviously we cleared that up. I was like, you know, I have a girlfriend I love very much, and you know, you were like, yeah, no, it's not like that at all. Yeah. But that actually breaks up a very good point. I mean, you are a good looking lady, you're obviously a beautiful girl.
Very nice.
Does that happen a lot in the industry?
I suppose.
Not your industry, I mean, just generally.
Well, it just happens a lot anywhere, like. I suppose
men are fucking pigs, man. We are pigs.
I don't think most of you are though inside. Like, I like to believe that everyone is just kind of, who does that is kind of misguided.
Does that shit happen to you? Are you prevalent on Instagram and stuff like that?
No, I don't really go down for Instagram. I don't really know what it's about. I'm not very like posy, putting
that's bullshit. You're lying now, because I've seen your Facebook.
You know what? I can't.
You
help
and
it.
You and that you Victoria. Know exactly. You know what I'm talking about. Victoria. Yeah,
yeah, I'm going out with her tonight, actually.
Are you? Shit. So you and Victoria.
To Camden.
Yeah. You and Victoria. Where else in Camden are you going?
Blues Kitchen.
Oh, Blues Kitchen's bad. Have you been before?
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that place. Yeah. Are you going for dinner or are you just going for drinks?
Dinner, drinks, and then wherever the night takes.
Whatever
us.
The fuck happens, right? Yeah. That's good stuff. Do you know what? I would, if I didn't have work tomorrow, I would totally join you.
You should join us.
I would not. I would. My girlfriend won't. She needs
I'll
me
bring
to.
Her.
She won't. She won't. Aww. Come. She won't. She's got loads of shit to do. I would totally come if I could, but I can't.
Okay.
I've got work, but yeah, for sure, I would totally join you. Blues Kitchen's good times, man.
Yeah.
I like yeah. It's good music, good food, good food.
Jamming sessions.
Oh, is that what you're going for?
No, but I don't know when they're on. I'm thinking of maybe bringing my ukulele one time. And
do you play the ukulele?
A little bit.
Fuck
just
off.
A little bit.
Are you sure?
I do like it. I'm not very good.
After the show, you got to show
me.
Okay,
after the show.
After the show, you got to show me, because I have no idea. So you play guitar?
I have, well, a bit. Okay. I have musical instruments around the house. You can see there's a piano there, there's guitar. In the other room, you'll find a glockenspiel and a ukulele.
What the fuck is a glockenspiel?
I'll show you what a glockenspiel is.
Yeah.
It's one of those intro things. Ding, ding, ding.
Oh, like a xylophone.
Yeah.
Okay.
But that's a xylophone, I think it's made of wood.
Yeah, because you just offered me to do my intro. Kind of like, you know, when they do it in like American high schools in the 50s?
Yeah.
Like ding, 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 ding.
Sweet. I do like sound effects. Sound effects
okay.
are great.
All right, awesome. Nice. Yeah. All right, so yeah, but you are a poser, not gonna lie to you. I'm sure you're probably, when the social lubricant gets in, you have a few beers or whatever.
I think I'm just naturally, I just look like I'm posing, and other people are taking these photos. I hardly ever like take any photos.
Yeah,
it's weird.
I don't believe you.
I'm serious.
Anybody who knows Claire, go onto her Facebook and then tell me that.
Okay, some of them do look quite posy actually. Yeah. But
you and Victoria,
well, yeah,
yeah, she's Russian.
Is
she Russian? I'm asking.
No.
I have this image in my head that she's this Russian blue-eyed,
well,
black-haired.
She does look very striking.
She's, yeah, she's a good-looking chick,
she's
man.
She's very gorgeous. But no, I think her heritage is like Scottish and French and English.
What does she do?
She works in hospital at the moment.
She's like a nurse.
She is... I think... Well, she basically deals with life that comes at her in the A&E department.
Right, okay.
So, she, yeah, you can imagine what
that's. Is it a local, does she live local, or is she?
She, yeah, she lives in Isleworth.
Okay, yeah, that's down by Hillingdon area.
It's, well, yeah, kind of, but it's more towards, like, Twickenham, Richmond.
Yeah, like Slough, that sort of direction.
Yeah, down a bit.
Yeah, I know it is. How the fuck do you know her, then?
We went to university together.
And did graphic design.
She didn't do graphic design. She actually did filmmaking, film studies.
And now she does hospital work.
Yeah.
Okay, that works. What did I say earlier?
I know.
People who went to university don't do university shit.
That's right.
Unless you're like a lawyer.
Yeah.
And even then, some people are like, oh, so I studied law, but now I work at EE. Like
no one really knows.
Nobody knows. At that age. That's why I'm glad I didn't go to uni.
Oh, okay. You didn't go.
I went to college. I did art. I love drawing.
I did art. Awesome. Yeah,
I love drawing. I'm a really big fan of drawing. I'm not very good.
Well, I'd like to see your drawing.
I'll show you some shit. I got a few things on my phone, but I'm more of a copier than my own work. Like, okay. I will sit down and draw something that I see, as opposed to like, I don't know, like making up something original.
Like a goblin unicorn.
Yeah. Okay. Like a goblin unicorn. That reminds me. I saw a t-shirt and it had a picture of Kim Jong-un.
Oh, yeah.
Kim Jong-un? Kim Jong-il? Kim Jong-un on a unicorn.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because there's two, right? Il was the dad.
Il was the dad, yeah.
Yeah, so he's, I think the picture on the photo was Un, and he's on a unicorn that's blasting rainbows out of his eyes in the clouds.
Sounds about right.
I want that shirt in my life. It's on a website called That Shirt Was Cash. Okay, so we digressed. We were just like talking about your friends and shit, but it doesn't matter. Whatever, do whatever the fuck we want.
It's your show.
Yeah, fuck it, my show. I dictate the rules. Whatever the fuck we want. Yeah. So were you ever tempted to do any other type of animation? Like, let's say, I don't know how to say it, conveyor belt animation. Like Simpsons, like like Family Guy, like a mainstream show where they just kind of like, just draw this, trace it, move it on, trace it, move it on. Because is that how it works, or do you do it on a computer, or what's the deal?
I reckon it's all, well, yeah, mostly on computers now.
And yours is all hand-drawn, all the way, this page by page.
Well, yeah, this project particularly is.
And then you digitize it.
I have to, yeah, to get it all together, because we're working in layers. But yeah, I wasn't really drawn to like the systematic kind of like cookie cutter way of doing things. I always make it hard for myself, I think.
Yeah.
And I always will continue to do that, I think.
Yeah. Until you're a big boss.
Until I'm the boss, and then I can like have lots of minions I can
pop
pay.
Bottles and fuck bitches. Yeah.
That's right. How many bitches can I get?
Yeah, that's it. Like,
up in her. Oh, I hope my mum won't listen to this.
Yeah, no, yeah. My mum doesn't listen to this, so okay. It's all good. You're good. So just because my mum doesn't, means there's no relevance whether or your mum will or not. But if she does, make sure she likes it. Share it, subscribe. So you're not interested in that. That's a very good term, by the way. Cookie cutter. I never heard that term before. But okay, yeah. So you're not interested in that. You're always about doing your own thing. That's fucking awesome.
Much,
I respect that. I respect that. A lot of people just fall into the line. They just fall into line. They're like, I'm gonna do this, and that's it.
Well, I'm poor, mind, but
sorry,
I'm poor at the moment.
But you're rich in wisdom, and that's the important thing. Wisdom doesn't pay the rent, but it's there.
That's right. I want both, basically. Yeah. That's the aim.
But you can make your own. I mean, if you work hard enough and you stick at it, eventually you get there. That's fantastic. So what would you say, do you watch any other animation? Like, so a lot of people I know that are into animation, they're into anime.
Yes.
Like manga.
Yes.
Yeah, are you into that?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Leander must love you, man.
Oh, yeah.
He's like, my girlfriend? Shit, she loves cartoons, motherfucker. My girlfriend hates cartoons. Oh. Not now. She watches Dragon Ball Z with me now.
Oh.
Every week. We watch them from Japan.
Man, I don't think I've watched Dragon Ball Z, actually.
You're not?
No.
You need to sort your life out. I'm wearing Dragon Ball Z shirt right now.
Oh, wow.
Super Saiyan Bros. Yeah, it's like
the hair is like that.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, spiky hair. Well, all anime really has spiky hair, apart from... No, I would say all apart from maybe the Howl's Moving Castle kind of guy.
Yeah. Oh, that's my favourite kind of
thing. Oh, is that your favourite kind of anime, is it?
Yeah. And you're like,
it's beautiful, though. No. I like it. It's beautiful stuff. It's Studio really Ghibli. Studio Ghibli, that's it. It's beautiful work.
Yeah, it's very deep actually for kind of kids stuff.
Mm, yeah.
But that's good.
Much like The Animals of Farthington Wood.
Oh, very, yeah.
That they did Watership Down. Same animators, right? Yeah.
I think so.
That show was deep.
Watership Down was brutal.
It's deep shit. And they show that shit to kids. That shit comes on at Christmas.
Exactly.
And kids are like, why is the rabbit killing the other rabbit?
Why is that on his head on a spike.
Yeah, it's fucked up, yeah, man. And they were like, yeah, I'm totally watching this shit. So your animation is more like the snowman. It's kind of soft, right? Soft animation.
But then it's got a dark kind of undercurrent. And I like comedy as well. I try to be funny. This particular film, Puddle, seeing as it's written by someone else and directed by someone else, it's not funny. It's not like my style. But I've made it kind of like part of me because I really saw something in it. So it's not comedy. It's more about... It's dark, but it's more about coming to terms with a loss. So it's about a little boy who's lost his mum.
Oh man,
it's quite hard to deal with, actually, I think. And also for both of us, like as filmmakers, me and Marissa, the director, we have to think about death a lot, and we have to come to terms with what we think about it. And through this film, it's kind of helping us. Even though it's really like we end up crying a lot.
Yeah, you will do.
Together. I think just because the story moves us so much and just we're so into it that we can't help but just be moved by it. Like every time now, it's getting so close to...
It's amazing what something like that can do.
Mm.
That subject specifically, death, is a lot of... It creates a lot of narrative, whether you like it or not. Like it does do it. I wrote a film.
Cool.
Never made it. Don't have the funding to make it. I'm kind of past that stage now, but I wrote it at the time, which was about it was off the back of my old man passing away. When my old man died, he died in my arms. He died at home in my arms, and I had to give him CPR and everything like that. It really fucked me up for a long time. And I blamed myself for a really long time because I remember when I was giving him CPR, I could feel like his chest cracking, like underneath my hands. You know, it was the whole thing fucked me up. And I wrote something, and I wrote it, and I rewrote it, and I rewrote it about 5 or 6 times, all whilst I was in that grief period. And then afterwards, when I didn't get over it, but when I sort of came to terms with it and everything like that, I remember rewriting it, just kept saying, it needs to be darker, it needs to be more painful, because nothing I could put on paper could annotate the pain that I felt. And then I actually ended up finishing it, and then ended up never making it. It's kind of like one of those, like the unfinished painting, where I was like, you know what, I'm done with this. Like I expressed it in the way I need to express, and now I don't need to make it because I have no need to tell that story anymore, because that story is that part of the story of my life is over, and I'm done with it now. But it is amazing how, well, obviously your Puddles is about death.
But what a great way to express, like to deal with that, with the grief, to put it down, to try and express it. And you tried to do it in a creative way, which just shows what kind of person you are.
Oh, don't get me wrong, there was a lot of alcohol involved too. Like I would sit there and just drink like JD and stuff like that. But I found a way.
It could have just been the alcohol.
Yeah, no, it could have. And don't get, like a lot of people were worried, like people that I knew were worried about me, were like, oh, maybe this might tip him over the edge and stuff like that. But I just, you know what the thing is? I was just not that kind of person. Like, but you just sort of just, you end up, you sack up. You're just like, I'm just going to get on with this. But yeah, no, I really wish that script is long gone now. Like I've deleted it.
You've deleted it. Wow.
It's gone, yeah. No, like I said, that point in my life for me is past. I don't need to revisit that dark place. That's a dark place that I need to go to, you know? So it's kind of like, I lived it. I still live it every day. Occasionally you think about it and stuff like that. But now that I'm older, it's 3 years now. So I'm just kind of like, I get it. It's part of, death is a part of life. And I guess that's sort of my way of saying that even your story about death, it's bringing life, because it's bringing life to these drawings, it's bringing life to your animation, it's bringing life to your emotions, because you and Marissa are crying about that shit. And that, who wrote it? Who's
Marissa.
Yeah. Does it come from a place that Marissa experienced, like something like that?
I don't think so. I think it just purely came from just her mind. She's such a great storyteller.
Yeah.
And she didn't even need a catalyst for it. She just kind of pours things out. But I think the main point of it maybe was to kind of touch other people. I think she was thinking of others when she wrote this, especially children who've had a loss. And without it trying to sound like worthy or anything, it will probably help children to deal with the loss maybe of a parent or just anyone like who can be touched by that story. And I just hope that people get something from it. It is quite cathartic. It's not depressing, even though it is, it's very intense in the middle, but there's a cathartic ending, which is really great. It's not happy ending. It's the beginning of a new chapter. It's like, now we know how to start dealing with the grief.
Yeah.
And it's Eddie and his dad starting to do that without the mum moving forward. It's very, like, even saying it now, I feel a bit like,
yeah.
So that's how far I'm into it. Like, I'm really,
well, I truly have no doubt that that translates onto the digital page, I guess.
Yeah,
when you say that,
I really,
but
hope so.
I bet it does. I haven't seen it, obviously, but I'm looking forward to it.
You'll see the trailer. You'll see the trailer.
Yeah, because you send me the link. We'll watch it afterwards. But
cool. Yeah.
Yeah, we'll see the trailer. I would do it now. I would actually just watch it now whilst we have the mic on. But I think YouTube won't let me do it.
Okay.
I think their rules of, like, they'll kick me off and say it's copyright infringement because I'm using somebody else's content in my content, and I haven't paid for it or gotten that. Because whilst I may have your verbal permission, I think I need actual permission from the owner of the property.
Right. Okay.
It's just the way they are, fucking YouTube.
I didn't even know this. But...
Yeah. That's why, like, the you know, the intro song, the really crummy intro song to this podcast,
yeah.
I had to pay for it.
Yeah.
So I had to find royalty free music.
I know about that. Don't worry.
Yeah. Yeah. Make a one off payment and then cut it. So I basically had to pay for 5 seconds of sound.
Yeah. But it's worth it.
Yeah. But the thing is, it is. But that is the way things are. Mm-hmm. Like, you just have to take that on the chin, mm-hmm. and there's a cost of doing business.
Mm-hmm.
But some people just don't accept that shit. Some mm-hmm. people are like, no. I want everything for free. And sometimes I just want time to go eat a bowl of dicks. No, I'm sorry, dude, you can't do that. It's just the way it is.
Have 5 bowls this time.
Yeah, or a bag of.
Yeah, bag
said
off.
Dicks, yeah.
I believe that was Louis C.K.
Louis C.K.
Have you heard of that?
Yeah, movie? I know who Louis C.K. is. I'm just trying to remember which podcast, which comedy stand-up it would have been.
Oh.
He did a really funny thing where he talked about being white.
Yeah.
And he said, I love being white. In fact, you can go back into any time period of your history and be white and it would be okay.
That's right. That's why.
That's so fucked up. Funny. You're mixed race, but you look, I would have thought you look maybe Greek,
yeah.
or maybe Persian. I don't say Persian, I'm going to say Iraqi, because Persians like to say, oh, I'm from Persia. I mean, you're from Iraq.
People say that.
Yeah, you got that going on, but you're actually half Caribbean, half British.
You're half Irish.
Half Irish, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
It's the same fucking thing. British and Irish, basically it's the same thing.
It's white people, but, yeah. You know, Irish.
Well, it's kind of like saying some white people, they don't associate with Eastern European white people. Do you get what I'm saying? English people, like, I'm white, you're not white, you're Eastern European. There's that divide there that, you know, doesn't, shouldn't exist, but it,
like,
does.
I don't like any of the divides, to be honest. Like, people are people. I'm
like, did you vote for the Brexit or did you not vote?
I voted, and I obviously voted stay.
Okay.
Like, many...
I didn't vote at all.
Oh. Okay.
I didn't feel like I was correctly informed. It was a very rushed thing.
It was a rushed thing, and I feel like I voted to try and counteract any kind of, like, decision, because staying in is not, you know, it's just how things are already. Like, leaving is like a whole other kettle of...
People are afraid of change, but staying the way things are at the moment isn't good either. And that's, I think that was the problem. There were a lot of people telling me why we should vote to stay, but there weren't people who were telling me why we shouldn't leave. Does that make sense? Like,
there wasn't a very strong argument. Yeah.
There was no strong arguments either way. So I just said, I'm going to not vote because I can't make an informed decision.
Okay.
But then on the flip side of that, I didn't complain.
Mm.
And I think that there is a really important thing that needs to happen there. If you're not going to vote, shut the fuck up. Because like, don't sit there and start proclaiming that you know what's best if you didn't make a decision to try to vote. I mean, by all means, if you voted and you lost or you won, go ahead, talk about it all day long. I don't give a shit, but I didn't vote, so
I was very surprised actually, because, well, for one, I feel like we live in this little bubble in London and we don't really connect well with the rest of England, the UK. And I was just like, yeah, everyone's going to vote Remain, obviously, because who would want to just destroy all of this and just go? But lots of people have different points of views
outside of London,
It's like...
And those voices were heard.
Yeah, they were.
But it's the rhetoric in that space. I mean, like, you need to... and this goes not just with England, this is around the world. You need to sort of, like, just wait for that, the older... gods to just die off, do you know?
You need to die.
And just like, just you need to wait for the older generation to just sort of just pass away and die off, so that the new blood from the new way of thinking can then take power, and then we can make some better decisions. But until we still have the old rhetoric of the people from private schools and they went to Haberdashers or whatever, John Lyon or Harrow on the Hill school, all these fucking douchebags who have no real knowledge about what the real world is like.
That's it. Misinformed.
Yeah. And I mean, like, take David Cameron or even fucking Theresa May, who is the new prime minister. Take that bitch, put her on minimum wage, right? Put her on child tax credits, put her on whatever, right? And see how quickly she survives. She went, oh no, I can't do this.
It's a very interesting experiment.
Yeah.
And it's one, I think, that was proposed to a member of parliament once.
David Cameron.
Was it David Cameron?
David Cameron, yeah.
Yeah. And he never did. He never.
Yeah, because he's a fucking douchebag. That's why. It's media. That's all they're doing. No, I'm not going to do that. Of course, you're not going to do that because you can't afford to do that.
He should have.
Yeah, and that's. I think, like, I also am a firm believer that wars should be fought by the people that want them.
Oh my God! Imagine all of the high powers in a wrestling ring, mm-hmm. greased up. It could be. So
Frankie goes
show.
To Hollywood.
Yeah, exactly.
reference you just made there.
Yes, I have actually. Yeah. I just realised. But imagine if they had like special outfits, like the luchadors and like, everything. The mask. Imagine Theresa May and her like glittering kind of onesie.
The problem is, though, I wouldn't want the fate of the country based on Theresa May's fighting ability.
But imagine how buff she'd have to be. She'd have to train up.
Well, yeah, but the... just imagining her now, like, just like a wrestler. But what they should do is, I mean, if you put it this way, if you feel that Iraq needs to be subjugated by England and we need to be above them, then take the Iraqi guys, take the people who want the war here and parliament, whoever, and then grab a gun, slap them on the ass, go, here, show us what you're made of. You guys want the war, stop sending other people. They don't want to fight. You know, like, some people want to go into the army, and that's cool, but they want to go into the army for different shit. Discipline, way of life, whatever. Yeah, don't get me wrong. Some people are fucking insane. They want to go kill people, and that's cool. If that's down to you, then fine. But they should let those fucking people deal with that shit.
Yeah, and then leave the civilians out of it as well.
Yeah, I don't want to pay for your war. I got better things to pay for, like education.
Yeah, education is the main thing, I think.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Education, let's not build any more prisons, please. Let's stop doing that.
No. I mean,
America's worse for that shit.
Yeah.
Really bad.
It's awful. Oh, God. It's just crammed, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, the thing is because they still have things like, and even here we have the same thing, like mandatory minimum punishments for like alcohol, for drug related things like marijuana and stuff that shouldn't be, like, it's even though it has medical benefits, even though the government of the United States has, and in the UK, hold the patent for marijuana being legalized as a medical drug, so they hold the copyright for the process to how it would become, how they can monetize it. At the moment, it's worth more to them to make it illegal. It's worth more to pharmaceutical companies. It's worth more to everybody for that drug to be illegal, because prison systems, they rely on prisoners to be housed, so they get that funding from the government. So it's all one big fucking circle that goes around.
Very, very correct.
I'm not gonna go like conspiracy theorist on it, but I think this is that's just like general knowledge. That everything, money runs the world, and as long as things like marijuana that pretty much guarantee like a small term incarceration or a fine where somebody has to pay for it, they're gonna keep that illegal until such time that it no longer makes them money. And this is why the people that the older gods need to just die off so we can start changing those rules. We end up just fucking taking people's money. But we should let's go back to animation. We went all political. Sorry guys, I know you wanted to hear about animation. I don't know what happened there. We just turned the subject on. Do you ever watch any Japanese anime apart from like obviously Studio Ghibli?
Well, recently my brother made me watch Kill la Kill.
I haven't seen it. I know it's on Netflix, but is it any good?
It's insane. It's good.
I'm sure there's a lot of killing involved.
Yeah, well, there's a lot of like weird sexual things involved with a suit.
Oh man. Fucking, it's come on, Asia, sort this out. Japan and their weird, do you know what that's called? Like, obviously not Kill la Kill because that's mainstream, but there is a form of pornographic animation in Japan. Hentai.
Yeah, hentai. Yeah. I have heard of that.
It's fucked, man. Yeah. I've come across it. But
it's not so bad as that, I don't think.
Yeah, yeah, but it's on the fringe. It's on the cusp, yeah. I've seen a few, I own a few films which are on the cusp of that on DVD. Where there's one called, he's a mouthful, Yuratsuka Doji. It's the legend of the Overfiend, and that's just on the cusp. I think the only thing that doesn't make it that is that occasionally you won't see like dick going in vaginas. It's almost like,
but you see a wang.
No, you don't even see a wang. Yeah, you don't see wang. You see tits.
Oh yeah, you see tits in Kill la Kill.
Yeah, you see tits, but you don't see wang, and you don't see erect wang going inside vagina. And you don't even see vagina, I think. I think that's the only thing. But you can film a sex scene without showing sex.
Yeah.
And have it be gratuitous. Yeah. And that's, and you know what always gets me, whenever I come across something like that, because I'm a guy, I watch porn, right? There's always a section on your porn tube websites thingies where it says cartoon porn or whatever. And, I've never been down there, but I've unfortunately come across it. I always think, what the fuck is the animator thinking when they're drawing this?
And who are they?
Some fucking lowly guys.
No, maybe they're young students getting experience.
In Japan? Yeah, that's a good point. I never actually thought about
disturbing.
That.
They're like, oh God, I have to do this again.
That shit's really popular around the world. There's like all those, there are people that jack off to that. Like, I've had people try to explain it to me where they're like, yeah, but you watch porn, right? And I went, yeah. And they were like, yeah, so this girl with the big boobs and the big R's, she's not realistic, is she? And I went, well, she's real. And they were like, yeah, but you're never going to go near her. You're never going to touch her, right? And I went, yeah. And they're like, well, it's the same with the cartoon, man. I was like, yeah, but the thing is, these are two real people getting their rocks off. That's a cartoon where somebody's drawing that shit.
I don't know.
I mean, I was like, that's, I almost thought, oh my God, I'm going to lose this argument right now.
Yeah, maybe.
But then I was like, no, because I actually, if I'm going to watch porn or whatever, I'm going to watch human beings do it, because that's the entire point. I don't want to watch cartoons, but
you might come around to it. Who knows? You might become a fan.
It's not my thing. Sorry, you going to draw me some?
No.
Do you know what? Do you know what annoys me whenever I draw something? And this will probably be, and I'm sure that some artists, and I guess the way you're going to explain around it is, some artists just find a way to make it different and make it their touch. I can't draw hands.
Hands are notoriously difficult.
Yeah.
And once you focus on it and get it right, you can do it. Yeah. Like, seriously, you can do anything. I wasn't that good a drawer when I was younger, but I made myself be because I really wanted to do it.
Yeah.
So you gotta really want to draw those hands.
Yeah, I can't draw, and I lose my shit. I'm like, fuck this.
Do they look like a bunch of bananas?
They don't even look like hands. They look like turkey, like a turkey. It's shit. Gobble gobble. It's nonsense.
I want to see the hands you draw.
Like, well, I haven't drawn anything. But I can't do his back. The best way I can draw a hand, I put my hand on the paper, yeah, and I draw a line around it. There's a hand right there, and then I'll turn it into a turkey.
That's a valid way, but
I can't do it. I just I really, that's why, like, anybody who's an animator can do it. I actually invented a character called Dill. I can draw him quick as well.
Okay.
I can't draw him right now, but it was a really. Do you ever listen to, what music do you listen to?
Oh God, what was I listening to now? I'm listening to Radiohead today, and before I was listening to Marvin Gaye.
Okay.
So just everything.
Do you ever listen to a band called Korn?
Yes, I love Korn.
Okay.
Well, I mean, I was very like into them when I was a teenager.
I'm still into it. Well, not so much now, but they had a front cover to one of their albums called Issues.
Now, what did that look like?
It had a doll, like a weird doll with a button eye on it.
Yeah, I remember that.
Like a teddy kind of doll.
Yeah.
So I created a character called Dill, and I actually drew like panels of a whole TV series for him. Ooh. Like if I ever made a series for him, like a comic series. Never followed it through. I was in college at the time, and did my whole thing on it, and I got like real good marks on it and everything from this character called Dill.
Wow.
That I did. I created a whole backstory. He had a pet. He had a pet octopus. He had like it was a giant octopus.
Yeah.
And it was almost like a mixture between that character, if he had fallen into the world of Rocco's Modern Life.
Oh, yeah.
Do you remember Rocco's Modern Life on Nickelodeon? Yeah.
Yeah, it was kind of sick.
Yeah.
I remember the dog used to, like, eat armpit gunk.
Yeah, that sure was fucked up. Rocco's Modern World? Modern Life. Rocko's one of them. Modern Life. That's right. Rocko's
Modern Life. Yeah,
you're so sad. You're so sad.
Awesome at the same time.
Yeah. Yeah. No. So I sort of create a little mixture of that.
Excellent.
And I never fucking follow through it. And even now, when I'm talking to you about this, I'm like, man, I would totally love to draw that shit.
You have to follow through.
And it was really good draw. It was really simple, like, because I couldn't draw hands and I can't draw feet. Mm. So I created this doll character, which he was like a weird doll with like stitchings, and he was held together. He had like parts falling out of him and stuff like that. But he was like this playful character who lived in this really world where that shit exists.
Yeah.
And that's it. But awesome. I'll show it to you. I reckon I could draw it pretty quick if I had a piece of paper and a pencil. It wouldn't look amazing. it would just be a quick sketch of what that character looked like.
When we switch this off, then
I've got a pencil and paper. And that's what, and I never fucking did it. I really should have followed through. Hey, maybe we could collaborate.
The bowels of your creativity. Follow through with all of your things.
I'm doing it. This is it. This is me being creative.
Actually,
this is now my art, because I like having people like you on the show where we can just fucking talk about whatever.
Yeah.
You know, and it is like we've touched on animation, we've touched on other things,
yeah.
Touched on stuff you're working on, but then we've also talked about other shit. We're talking about, you know, fucking politics and cartoon porn.
Yeah.
You a video gamer? Do you play video games?
Only a little bit.
Is Leander a video gamer?
Not so much anymore.
I used to be.
Yeah?
I am. No, he used to be. I mean, oh, did he used to be?
Oh, yeah. Well, I suppose he used to play, like, GTA quite a lot.
Yeah.
Like everyone. He's now working with the director of animation of Rockstar North.
Oh, nice. Awesome.
And the director's like, he directed Ouija Sex.
Yeah.
So that's like a massive step up for him.
Yeah.
The world of film. But then to get on like a house on fire, they just won't shut up. Like,
awesome.
Once you get them talking, it's like forever. And Mondo's so lovely. He's
the guy.
The director, yeah.
Yeah.
Where
did they film the film? Where did they make it? Here in the UK?
Yeah, in London. In like
is it a comedy? Because it almost sounds like it's a comedy.
It is a comedy, yeah. Okay. Definitely a comedy. They just filmed it in a community centre, like they paid them and they paid the crew. It's the most professional like quick shoot I've been on.
How long was it?
It was a one day shoot.
The whole thing?
Yeah.
A movie?
Oh, it was a short film.
Oh, okay.
So yeah. One day, I mean,
because I've been on a few like video shoots with friends where like 30 seconds takes hours.
It does.
It's like, oh my god.
But like, seriously, if you've got the crew in place, if you've got the cinematographer and the grips and all the people doing what they know how to do, then it just speeds the whole thing up, and it just like, it's like clockwork. And I was just in this system. I was a cog. just helping out, being a runner, driving.
Well, it's a good way to, I guess, for you, sort of fill your bag of tricks.
Yeah.
Because then now you're like, when you want to do your own thing, what's it called?
The one you want to work on, fly. Yeah.
So working now that you, so it's a working title, yeah. But we'll say fly for the time being. So when you're doing fly, you're sort of building, you're adding to your repertoire,
yeah.
Where you're seeing Leander work on these films, yeah. And Mondo doing his direction piece, and yeah. You see, you're basically working with Marissa. So you're taking little bits from everybody, that's and right. You're adding it to your repertoire, and then you're putting your own accoutrement into it, and then Claire Winter Productions is born.
That's right.
That's right, man.
That's what I hope for.
Yeah, that's yeah. What we're waiting for. Okay, cool. So where can people find you?
So you can find me at clairewinteranimation.com.
Which will be in the description.
Yes. And I'll just put a link up. Well, could you please?
Yes, of course.
Put a link up to the trailer.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll link that up. And Stormhouse Productions.
Yeah.
I'll get that up there.
Stormhouse Pictures.
Stormhouse Pictures, sorry. Yeah, I'll get that up there as well.
And also the film that is screening at festivals at the moment.
Yes, absolutely. Get me that. Get me the trailer for that.
It's called After I Saw You.
Okay.
And it's good and it's moving and it's sweet. And
wait, is it like a relationship thing?
Yes. Yeah, it's totally about a relationship and about moving on and moving forward.
Nice.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. I'm gonna link that all up and we're gonna get it out there, and hopefully the next time I speak to you, young lady, you better be big balls.
I better be.
Yeah, you are. I'm sure you are. I have no doubt, but I'm looking forward to it. Guys, thank you very much for listening to the podcast, and thank you very much for listening to me and Claire. You know where to find her. Any more information, feel free to find it down in the description, and there'll be links to everything there. Cool. Peace. Anything else you want to say before we go?
No, thank you so much for having me on, Leo.
No problem. Thanks for giving me the time. All right, guys. Love you loads. Be safe and peace. Hey, this is Leo here from What's the Dammage Podcast. If you like this week's episode, feel free to like, share, and subscribe, and do all that fucking shit. And hopefully we can get this worldwide. Thanks a lot. Peace!